David Cherry, Toronto Council Clerk.
Mr. Bass has passed, Toronto Aboriginal Services Council. Natalie Petishko, Social Development, Finance Administration.
Thank you, Madam Chair, by the way.
And Miguel Avila.
Omar Colon.
Usman Shakir, Director at the Human Rights University of Toronto.
And I'm the Director of the Human Rights Department of Toronto.
I'm Ben McIntosh, I'm the Economic Development and Culture Division.
I'm Joe Cressy, I'm the Junior Counselor for Trinity Spadina. Senior Counselor.
Ken Bull, City Clerk's Office.
Sego, my name is Lindsay Frenchmer, and I am Mohawk from Six Nations of the Grand River Territory. I'm Wolf Clan, and my spirit name is Wolf Hawk. It's a pleasure to meet you.
And if you didn't get the email, Lindsay is our new consultant here for the city, so she'll be joining us very regularly. We're really excited to have her here, not only because we've been without an advocate on city staff, but also to have such a qualified candidate, someone that's bringing new energy to the role. We love May, but it's as the season changed, so do staff, and we're really excited to have you here. So I look forward to a lot of positive discussions in the future, and very hopefully very positive developments. So we wanted to meet again to discuss the recommendation going to council next week on the support for reconciliation in Canada's walk for reconciliation. Just if I could, because we don't have a report in front of us, do we?
No.
No. Just to recap where we are and how we got here. So the recommendation is going to city council that would assign these funds to Reconciliation Canada for the production of this walk and a series of events that would lead up to it. We received a presentation originally of this at our meeting in November, where we recommend that we sent direction to city staff to come back with a recommendation on how we can support the walk. They came back with this recommendation at the last meeting. As you'll remember, we sent it to executive committee without recommendation. Executive committee, and partially this was probably my fault, I wasn't able to be there that day with a sick child at home to instruct them that I think they should have passed it to city council without recommendations as well. Instead, they adopted the recommendations. That doesn't mean that they can't change at city council. It's very common that we change recommendations coming from the committee. So just to say that they probably, had I said it, just put it forward without recommendations, I'm sure they would have. I think that they it forwarded without recommendations. This is great. I had thought that it went with recommendations. So it's at the same place we really were when it was in front of this committee. So we were hoping that we'd be able to. They did forward. Yeah, sorry, I read the first line, which would be forwarded to them with their recommendation. So we'll be debating this next week in council. I've had some conversations with Francis and Ken to send their regrets. They sent Ken sent me some details about conversations he's had with Crystal and others about what conditions they saw being appropriate to try to address this issue of the lack of local involvement in the planning and execution of an event like this. Just so, because I think one thing, and certainly having tried to get money out of our city staff for 5 years for this, and you'll remember we sent a recommendation to support the Grand Chiefs when he hosted a meeting in 2013, and all we were able to muster was $10,000. That was it. This, because we had a little bit more time, we didn't have a lot of time in that case, I think a little bit more thought was put in, and this number is inflated slightly, I would say more than slightly, quite considerably, by the fact that the city doesn't give in-lieu services or in-kind services anymore. We give money for in-kind services and then they pay them back. So things like road closure, permit fees, street sweeping after events, stuff that we would normally and have in the past given in kind to things like the Pride Parade and the Santa Claus Parade, I don't know what that number is, and I'm sure we can get an answer here today, but a significant portion of that is in-kind services that the city would have provided. So it's not as large as Dipper Valley, but as I think a lot of us thought when we first opened that report. So why don't I, and I've distributed this to community members, and this is sort of what, based on my conversations with Ken and Francis, what a motion could potentially look like that would significantly increase the amount of local participation in the planning and logistics of the event, as well as adding a component of local organizational involvement and promotion. And then I added to it the end that I thought that we could also add, it would be timely for us to ask the city for in this space. One is to identify and support a legacy project or projects that are consistent with the Truth and Reconciliation calls to action. And then finally, to finally get that report back from the city manager's office on our request for an Aboriginal Affairs office. My understanding is Edmonton has made some rather significant steps as late, and it would be nice not to have Mayor Don Iveson trump us on this one. Because we shouldn't use Trump, but to get ahead of us on this one. So why don't I just open it up for discussion amongst committee members and those that have joined us at the table as guests, and if there are staff who would get them also let in support in a supportive way on that.
I just have a question. Was reconciliation and were they invited to that? Were we expecting them?
I don't know what it was, a recent call meeting.
Yeah, I spoke to them last night,
yeah.
And my understanding is like they would have been available to be here by phone, but they do have staff in Toronto, but it seemed a little odd to have them in the room and in non-speaking capacity to ask them some questions.
Fine. No, that's fine. I just wanted to clarify. So
yeah.
You spoke to them yesterday.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. We'll start from the recap of the November session this year that I was not available. I did have David as a representative from Council Fire, and he did share that at the last meeting that there was never any approval from the actual affairs committee, but they understood that Reconciliation Canada was going to come back with something back again to the Aboriginal Affairs. So the February 9th Aboriginal Affairs Committee, I did register our objection first and foremost to the 150 years. That's significant. That's the base. We're not about to celebrate 150 years of settlers imposition on us, because of that 150 years, 13 years later after the VNA, there was the residential school. And so what we were intentionally not looking to have any type of celebrations. The second issue was that we had reached out, Council Fire had reached out to Reconciliation Canada to ask them to, and this was repeated at the February session, we had asked them to reconsider that again because the 150 years, and that they consider looking at joining us in 2018. That was the issue. It's not about, that wasn't about rejecting them per se, but falling under the auspices of 150 years. And so that was the basis of what we brought this issue forward. It had been discussed again at a follow-up meeting of March the 9th that Crystal and David did attend again with Reconciliation Canada and other parties to look at what positions that we could look at going forward. I know that there were some recommendations that were tentative, they weren't distributed to anyone that I understood, but there was a further letter that was taken by TASC collectively that you did receive and was sent to the mayor again rejecting this process. So we also were waiting for the emergency meeting to make sure that we're coming forward. At the meeting you identified there was not $500,000 per se in dollars, but there was an exchange, there would be an exchange of a check which would in turn be purchasing the services during that particular walk. And what was included in those services was the police services that would be required. That's one, that's another issue. The other issue that I raised was protocol. The protocol that we do look at is that the Haudenosaunee does not interfere with the Anishinaabe business unless we go through that process. Within Toronto, we have, although Toronto Council Fire is a member of the Ontario Federation of Indigenous Prevention Centers, they do not come into this to this municipality unless they're invited. So there are some inconsistencies that I've raised, but also at the table of task. If we're aware, we extend that, you know, to someone who's not even from this region, but it comes along with significant contributions. And if that's the case, then I need to reconsider a position that we would be taking for the Federation, being involved in all things that we do, that we, you know, that we did, that we did, you know, we did decide. So my conversation with you again was, you know, we cannot, we will not support anything going forward unless that was an initiative specifically driven by our community, for our community, you know, to support the Water Walkers or to support anything outside of the 150 years, which is not our celebration, you know.
I'm just going to share a few points here because, I mean, we can go on and talk about this, what has happened. But I think what has happened, if you look at, we did send a letter to His Worship John Toronto, the Mayor of Toronto, indicating there was a statement of commitment by the City of Toronto, and that was in 2010. And I guess we're at the advisory council here, as we sit here, we put a lot of hours in, and to be told that there was a $500,000 committed to Vancouver, which I do appreciate. I believe that we are Indigenous people across Canada. We are one. And I don't like the idea what happened. And one way is because we call the conquered divide. Well, that's dividing again. That's coming up again. And we're aware of that as Indigenous people here in Toronto. So as an advisory council here in Toronto, it was kind of like, it would have been nice to have that, to have been consulted on what was happening. So the transparency to me, I thought, wasn't there. And if there's a commitment from the City of Toronto and the mayor and the council that we why were we not included or involved in any of the conversations that occurred with this money being forwarded or granted to, which is still in the process to Vancouver. We believe in the walk for reconciliation, that's a positive. But just a matter, I think what happened is the transparency was lost somewhere. So what all came in a positive light is that how can we now bring this back to a level where we don't let this happen, that we do our transparent with everyone in Toronto. And like I say, I'll emphasize, we're all Indigenous people, we're all under one umbrella, and we all want to work for the same cause. It's just a matter of, I don't think if we went to Vancouver where we received the $500,000, I think we would probably get a response from the Indigenous people. So just having courtesy. And if you go up in the letter, we did send His Worship that indicates a lot. There's three areas that we're really looking at. And I'm not sure if you read the letter yet, but
I did.
Yeah, there's three areas. Have the city manager oversee the information of urban average describing slash framework across city departments and agencies and required benchmarks and quarterly reports. Two, invest in an Indigenous office within the City of Toronto that is adequately staffed and funded to support the work of realizing all seven areas of commitments in a timely manner. Three, require Indigenous equity lens to all grant-making bodies. So what we're asking is that those three areas would be nice if we could accomplish that, especially the office that, you know, Mike and Joe, that we've been advocating this for how many years now? And so it's just a matter of being first transparent with us. We do meet, we put a lot of hours in, we take time out of our working environment to come and speak on behalf of the advocates for our people in the urban city of Toronto. That's all we're asking. We're not asking a lot for that. I believe this happened in a it looks like a negative light, but it probably isn't. But we want to bring it back to a positive light where we can work together in harmony and transparency.
Maybe this is, and maybe it's a question to staff, because like with my understanding that and I might be wrong about the November recommendation, which was to put it in the hands of staff to come back with a recommendation. It didn't include a further dialogue with the committee until that recommendation came back. Now, what was unfortunate is that the recommendation
also add to it, considering EDC is the one that came up with the money. My understanding is exactly as you said. I mean, as the director of equity diversity, we got a motion from council identifying Mike Williams, EPC, and myself to support reconciliation work. We met. I believe EDC reached out to Reconciliation Canada, found out what it is that they need. They came up with a budget. We said, no, we can't support that. That's too much. Maybe maximum we can give you. It just so happened that EDC happened to have this money only for special events. And I'll let Ben explain that. I was involved because there was a whole engagement piece, particularly with multi-ethnic communities, particularly with students, like where, you know, to encourage them to have these engagement process be focused on truth and reconciliation, to create, that's the legacy piece, my understanding was, to create that knowledge, that understanding on truth and reconciliation. My job was to connect Reconciliation Canada to the communities so that in the spirit of reconciliation and with knowledge, they could then walk on September 24th or whenever the walk is, together. So that to me is the understanding. Usually the report would go straight to committee and council. However, I think we decided that it should come to the Aboriginal Affairs Committee. That's why we brought it as fast. Like we're talking November direction, by February meeting, you bring the entire report to the Aboriginal Affairs Committee and subsequently, right? So yes, you're right. The time frame is also very small, short. But also, Larry was talking about transparency, and I'm just saying that's what happened. There was no room for maneuverability in this. Am I correct?
Yes, and so just to add to that, to give a little more background on the process for how the Economic Development and Culture Division issues these grants. So following the Aboriginal Affairs Committee, the Reconciliation Canada submitted a proposal to the division, which included a budget and explanation of the event. Staff from the division evaluated the proposal using the criteria for the Major Special Events Fund grant program. It met the criteria, so we were able to recommend a grant. As Uzma mentioned, they provided an initial request, which was considerably higher, and so we went back and forth to negotiate that a little bit. The amount of $500,000 represents a little bit less than one-third of their budget, which is a standard grant award for this program. It also matches a contribution from the federal government to $500,000, so it sort of follows the standard one-third, one-third, one-third from each level of government. And as Uzma mentioned, we did want to make sure the recommendation came back to this committee. Normally it would not go to the stand committee, we just go to executive and council.
So can I just get some clarity as to Reconciliation Canada's sourcing the event in Toronto? Are they hosting others across the country?
No.
There is one in Vancouver.
Sorry?
There was one in Vancouver as well, I believe.
Come to the table.
They're doing that one.
Just a couple other points, and thank you for your presentation. So when we were talking about transparency, and you had the time to speak to Reconciliation Canada, however, with I acknowledge the City of Toronto of adding additional territory, the Haudenosaunee, the Anishinaabe, the Huron-Wendat, and the Indigenous peoples that we have here, there was only one group that they reached out to. They had the ability to do that, but missed out on the other. So am I to understand that if Winnipeg would have come to you and requested the same, or Edmonton would have requested the same under that same banner, you know, Abbey Affairs, or would have?
I think the only reason why they were considering it is because we as a committee made a motion for them to requesting it.
Yeah.
Joe?
Yeah, clear the situation we're in and then to discuss the path forward. First of all, and I think we need to acknowledge this, is the staff at the city have done yeoman's work to get us to this point on this. And, you know, it was this committee in November that said us to the staff, explore opportunities. And so our staff worked hard to explore what the opportunities would be and then came back to this community to say, here are the opportunities. And so I just want to note, it's not the duty of the staff to do the work that Reconciliation Canada should do. Right? It should be the work of Reconciliation Canada to go and meet with all of the different Indigenous groups in the city for the principles of Nothing About Us Without Us. You know, it's their job to do that work. And I just want to, because sometimes in this conversation, I found at times it feels like it's our staff who haven't done it. And the staff have done, they moved on an expedited timeline to get information back to us because of their commitment. So I just want to, so the issue as it relates to both the process and the transparency, and I said this at our last meeting, that to me is a fault in Reconciliation Canada. Right? They're coming to do a walk in Toronto and they didn't build support and outreach with enough of the groups first, initially, in Toronto. Now, that's not to say that they can't. That's not to say that the motion in front of us to ensure that there is a connection and a deep collaboration in the working group and any local procurement partners with organizations, it's not to say that it can't happen, but I think what's led us to this point, I just want to acknowledge it's not staff, is all. And so in terms of how we proceed, I mean, I think, Andrea, you've mentioned real concerns as it relates to anything to do with 150, right? And I think there's a point here, I think there's a real attempt to come up with a motion that will forge that collaboration, that will ensure that funds that are used are partnered with local contractors from the Indigenous community. So there's an attempt here to do that, and I recognize that, as well as to look for legacy projects consistent with the TRC's calls to action. That's a compromise motion, but it might, in light of the connection of 150, I understand it may not be good enough for, and it may not be appropriate enough for some. But this isn't, I think we found ourselves in a bit of a bind here, and we have a choice to make, which is, do we try to make the best of a bad situation and hope it works out, which is what we're trying to do, or do we say, you know what, lesson learned, let's, you know, the message to Reconciliation Canada is we respect you, we like you, we think you do important work, but the process wasn't good enough for the next time do it better. Right? I mean, and that's the choice I think we have to make, and I'm not coming here to propose one or the other, I just want to acknowledge that we're in a tight spot.
Just one last comment.
Yeah.
I want to acknowledge that by any means was there ever any indication they followed through what was required of them, and you're right. What should have been, could have happened, but didn't happen, was the party who was out asking for the dollars should have understood what our process is and what the court calls, and once you've got that in place, then actually come back here. And that's what I take exception to. One item. Anything under 150 is not, is we're being hypocrites. And because Council Barton, I know you try to add that into the issue, we deal with our the residential school survivors, and we have this project that we showed you last week, where it was the last, and I have since taken that to them across this region, because there's a part of it, and I've also advanced the 150. I want to know what their position is. And you need to know it's the same feeling that they have from the June 11th, 2008, an apology, you know, for what? So that's the same premise that I'm bringing back. Are we going to see them walk off that time? I don't think that we're at a place where we're going to create more division. And I appreciate the position that Larry always takes, and it's, you know, how do we work together? And I think by making things right, by being, you know, the whole issue of the intent of the TRC and the truth, I think that's a position that we'll stand by. But again, I acknowledge you and thank you for the work that you have done. Yeah.
I too articulate what Andy was saying. I wouldn't even know where they were starting to go as well, what else that really was. It's just a matter of, yes, we were in a bind, something happened, that's part of life, you just bump your roads, you just have to find out how you smooth them out. And by communicating like this in a good, positive light is the best way, not pointing fingers, etc. But just something did happen, that's why I kept mentioning transparency, and that's where the has to be about, we don't communicate. And again, as I indicated earlier, that they are indigenous, it's all about one. Just unfortunately, they're over in Vancouver, and we're in Toronto, and that's what happened there. But no, I believe in moving forward in a positive light. Let's all learn from this, whatever may have occurred. Let's move forward. And no, what the letter sent to our worship, John Torrey, I hope he reads it, and we do get a response from that, because that's what the letter went in for. I think with some I wouldn't say guidance, but some the tweak points they're taking, if we were to receive some good feedback on that, I think would help a lot, that we have the transparency starting to get it. So with that, I want to thank everyone in a positive way that we come together, and let's come together in a positive way from here on in. And you know, a lot of people's time where there will be a gap and we'll miss out some kind of communication. So with that, I want to thank everyone here today. Which,
can I ask you a question? Maybe EDC, is the federal money linked directly to that? Does it need to be spent in 2017?
Yes, it's for specific for you.
But would the money still be available to publish the event at a later time?
Probably not.
Yeah, it is tied to the Canada 150 program, so it's.
If they've got matching funds from the Fed 150, right?
Yeah.
Okay, well, since we don't really have any motions in front of us because we're not in committee now, is there anyone else that wanted to comment or to bring their advice to the table? I'm still.
Well, David, sure.
Yeah.
Just in terms of this proposed motion, I think it would be important to put some kind of timeline in there. If you're talking about working with the local groups, that there have to be some kind of commitment that they come here before the event and work with the local groups and set a lot of this up. If they sort of support this. Because I know in some of the discussions with them in some of the meetings I was in with Crystal, where we talked about working with local organizations, and that a lot of the local organizations already had reconciliation programs, had already done reconciliation engagement work, and that they should work with the local organizations. Their response to that was that, well, we'll come in for the walk. We'll have one of our engagement sessions. You can sit in on it and see how you want to become involved. So there seemed to be no sort of desire to sort of work ahead of time with any local organizations doing this kind of work.
So this is a timeline for setting up the advisory committee and to have those report backs come?
If this is the way things are going to proceed.
Now I'm putting my community hat on as opposed to my city staff hat on, which is that one of the ways that they can do the engagement, and I, you see, they're from outside, they don't know the communities here, so I'm sending them lists of all these community groups, non-Indigenous community groups, but they don't know them, right? So rather than starting a sort of cold calling them, why don't they work with the Indigenous groups that are here who have these organic relationships amongst themselves, but also with non-Indigenous groups, which is the purpose of it. And have that whole community engagement piece be done by local communities as opposed to Reconciliation Canada, which actually has no, you know, they don't have that knowledge base. Just thinking. I'm not sure.
Yes, Andrew. Not doing anything here.
No, what?
You know, what David was sharing with you is that he attended a March 9th meeting, and at that meeting, with Reconciliation Canada, where Crystal was also a representative, that they were not amenable, you know, to having us being involved, so that just justifies exactly the position we take, but where we could fit later on. It doesn't work. And with all due respect, I really appreciate the work that you do. It should be, the onus should be on the party. If I decide I'm gonna go to Vancouver, I better know my protocols. And before I go and propose absolutely anything, that did not happen. Did not happen. It should be a few to, you know, we have a number of groups here that one can ask for. Matter of fact, Council Fire has a representative in Vancouver who I encouraged to go meet, and she wasn't able to get together, but she did meet with Gina and made that same ask. Is there some way that we can revisit this again from us? No.
Joe? So since it's not a formal meeting and we're not passing a vote, I mean, here's where I'm at. I appreciate and respect the intent of reconciliation. really good. And I know that what they did in Vancouver was a tremendous success. And so I really respect what they've done and value their intent to broaden what was a success in Vancouver into other communities. Right? That's coming from a very good place, and I respect that. I'm concerned that it won't succeed. And I'm concerned that it won't succeed here because it's already started out poorly on the basis of getting ahead of the local community. There's an old saying, you know, get the inside onside before you go outside, which I always love. So, you know, they went outside before they brought the inside onside.
Okay.
And so I'm concerned that it started out poorly, and I'm also concerned, to be honest, that given what I've heard and seen, is there actually going to be a lot of people who are going to participate in a walk that doesn't seem to have a lot of local support that we're being asked to support with $500,000. And so this isn't a rapping on the knuckles of Reconciliation Canada from my perspective. I'm just not concerned that there's been a demonstration of local support to justify this type of investment. And so my preference would be to defer a decision on financial support until there's a demonstration of local support.
We don't have that.
I that's what we're not in a formal meeting. That's why I'm saying this is that's why I said off the top, like I'm not moving anything because we're not in a meeting. I'm just saying my opinion is I know staff have done what we asked them to do, and I appreciate that we've tried hard to find the middle ground because we all value each other's work and we value the work of Reconciliation Canada, and for that reason we don't want to come across that we're slapping on a wrist or like we want to find that way to move forward. And so, you know, I will support whatever our co-chairs, completely support whatever our co-chairs do, and will speak so proudly. I do have concerns that this isn't going to succeed. I mean, I'm an organizer. My life was at organizing marches and rallies before getting into politics. And I wouldn't be able to organize a march in Vancouver if I didn't have local groups organizing. I could set up a working group, but you know, I'm supportive of this is if we're comfortable that this will work. I'm just not convinced it's going to succeed. Chris,
maybe just to add 2 points, and it goes to what you're saying, Councillor. I have had a few non-Indigenous agencies call me up and say, "Crystal, what's this about? I'm going into a meeting. I have no idea what they're going to ask me." And they're doing the right thing. They're reaching out to their local Indigenous communities to try and find out is about, and I can't say anything yet because I don't know which direction it's going. My advice is only just to listen and hear, but you know, come back to the Indigenous communities first to see, you know, how we can all work together. The second issue is we're trying very hard as task and also as the committee to have a relationship directly with the mayor, so he works directly with us on local reconciliation. And I mean, I think we're moving forward with that slowly. One of these things is a letter to remind him that we're here to help. One issue that I took from the March 9th meeting was the Walk for Reconciliation has said that they have the clout and the power to work directly with the mayor and to have his ear, which is great. But I do see some damaging relationships if they're telling the mayor which directions to go in with reconciliation, and certainly not asking the local communities what they want. So that could be taking us steps further back rather than forward. And also, from a reputational standpoint with our non-Indigenous agencies and allies, just adding to the confusion and putting them in the middle isn't fair to them and in the relationships that we're trying to build with them. So I do see some issues as well with how it would move forward, and those are the types of things that I think would have to be addressed with them, that they will not talk to the mayor and make recommendations to him and call him up. They promise that they'd call him all the time and make sure he's following through, but with whose guidance? That's these are concerns that we did bring up on May 9th, and I'm not sure if we got the answers that we were looking for.
So, to be honest, I don't know where what we do on this, because the recommendations are coming to council. Like clearly Council Fire is a no on this. I had both co-chairs in a position that they were supportive of this approach, and this was the suggested approach from one of them. So I guess I can call all the members individually to get their to gauge their level of comfort with that direction, but like from this group, that that direction would be a no?
This is more of a question. Is this money earmarked specifically for this alone, or is it potentially able to be reprofiled to something of a similar nature?
It would be another funding request, that's it.
Understanding that it's earmarked specifically for events, but is a contract been signed? Is that the stage that we're at, or is this money able to be reprofiled?
The money would be repurposed for another special event. It's
just a question, not a suggestion, to be clear.
Yeah. So if the funding were not to be approved, it would have returned to the pool for other grants. So, and that is dedicated specifically for one-time major special events.
We're in a tough situation, I haven't been a member of this committee long enough. I don't have the same longstanding relationship with the indigenous groups in our community to be able to speak as to what the right way is for. I just want to know, like, this is just my own from being at the last couple meetings. And so, you know, if the feedback we've got from the co-chairs and others is that this is an appropriate way to go, I'm supportive of that. Based on what I've seen and heard, I don't think this is true. I'm skeptical that this walk will succeed. And I'm worried that if it doesn't succeed, it will look poorly on us. Right? And so, you know, that we try to find a middle ground, but, you know, a walk that's, it sounds like federal government putting in $500,000, us putting in $500,000, it's more than $1 million on a walk, which, as far as I can see, doesn't have a lot of local support. And so, if they have this big walk in the fall, and if it goes well, we have tens of thousands of people, been great, we've made it work, but if it doesn't go well, you know, good luck getting support for another walk, you know, if we want to host one. And so my preference would be to say to Reconciliation Canada, we appreciate the work you're doing, we value it, and we support you, but we prefer that you develop a local organizing committee before we're prepared to sign off on, to make sure that we know it's real, before we can sign off on any funding requests. And I know that might jeopardize the funding requests and timelines, but that's, so I can go, I'm happy to follow the guidance and will. I'm not convinced.
Sorry, being new, you have lots of questions. One more question is it possible to layer in a commemorative aspect into this? So for example, you're looking at doing a walk, which I can appreciate. Where is the permanency and sustainability in that initiative? I think when you look at the amount of money that's on the table, you do want to be able to demonstrate something perhaps longer term as a thought, maybe. Is there any thought around commemoration activities sort of being woven in and layered, given the fact that this may be the only opportunity right now on the horizon that has any financial resourcing attached to it that is reconciliation based?
My understanding was that commemoration on a legacy piece was the community engagement. And my understanding was that the community engagement was obviously not with the indigenous communities. I just assumed that the indigenous communities would be along doing the engagement, but the non-indigenous communities, particularly the, you know, immigrant communities, refugee communities, students, et cetera, et cetera. That's why Mr. Munoni is here from UFT, et cetera. So that the message of truth and reconciliation, which is, you know, can be taken across the board, and that the walk itself would be in the spirit of reconciliation. However, I do appreciate what Crystal is saying, that you know, what is the messaging around truth and reconciliation if the indigenous groups are not involved? I think that's a very pertinent question, and, you know, that's worth thinking about. But to me, that's the commemoration, that's the legacy piece. Okay. Yeah.
At the meeting that Chris and I had when we talked about a commemorative piece or a leave behind, I think what they had discussed at that time was this very sort of general kind of thing, an understanding of reconciliation. And I think we explained to them at that time, the organizations in Toronto Council Fire, Native Canadian Center, work on a daily basis with workshops and engagements putting forth the idea of understanding reconciliation. And what was it that they were bringing that would be new or helpful? And it, and again, it's from this outside group coming in, and what they're telling us is better than what's already here.
One of the things, Council Fire has had our, in the translation, and seeing ourselves helping each other project since 2001. We're now entering our 17th year with the residential school survivors, and in Toronto, is, in Toronto there's approximately 125 survivors that we do work with, but there are family members that gravitate to the city. And so we've had them involved right from the onset of the TRC, which has been a tremendous healing process for them. We've raised dollars. We've been a part of a TRC working group, which also involves the other church groups, you know, universities, colleges, and local agencies. We've been afforded to have, excuse me, to raise enough dollars to send the survivors to all the national gatherings. We've also been host to a regional gathering, which is extremely successful in 2012, that we collectively raised funds for, and called upon the City of Toronto to host some of the legacy pieces here, and we appreciate. And so when the walk took place on May the 31st, 2015, we worked in collaboration with that across Canada, and we walked with them. We organized a walk here for Toronto. It was a very rainy day, but we walked, you know, because we said it was refreshing. And then we send our survivors and their families by coaches, and we send them off to Ottawa to join the rest of the other people across the country, including Reconciliation Canada. And once that come to a closure, moving forward, we established our group, and we know that Truth and Reconciliation had concluded its mandate, and we named ourselves Restorative Relations. No longer TRC, but Restorative Relations, and to look at how do we start to plan out and roll out these, you know, these involving not just the survivors within this city, but also ensure we reach out to the other centers, friendship centers, and our colleagues, as well as the schools and the other religious denominations, to show how we are moving forward. We're very cognizant about the protocols, and when we remind our colleagues around the board. So TRC is come and gone. It's done its reports, and so for us moving forward, you know, that's something that and we do have. We did share at last night. It was really good about putting together some commemorative legacy that we're looking to do here as a permanent site. We shared with you in that pamphlet that we had, along with the poster, that we've been able to solicit donors from the province as well as the feds. Certainly we were really clear we were not, it was not 100, we had the 150, part of 150, and they concurred, and so we were looking at the 2018, and with that, this is why we were looking at reaching out to you know, Reconciliation Canada to see if they would join forces. My conversation, and I'm sure she's had the same with Gina, that we wanted to know what our position was, because if it wasn't here, then they can always take and apply a walk in another city, and that, you know, that he would have been, and she spoke with Vancouver. And so there wasn't a lost boss, but I was really clear with her, because she's also a new dog. She came from the same community that I do, and be really clear on the protocols that she understood, and I wanted to make sure that this community, who is made up of quite a number of agencies beyond the service agencies, you know, have a voice. And we do not interfere with the arts group. We try to make sure that what we're doing is that we follow that respect. And so I appreciate your comments, and Joe, but you're right. You know, about us without us is pretty clear. You know, and again, not trying to belabor, but I will not disrespect the survivors, and should there be something that comes up, whether it's at the University Council, I'm not sure that I'll garner the support of my the residential school survivors, and also be present too as well. No.
Okay.
So just to add a note on the process for the Anticipated Grant, if it were to be approved at City Council, our staff would work with Reconciliation Canada to complete a detailed proposal and agreement. As part of that agreement, we have to identify specifically their legacy proposals. If there's any conditions that the committee wished to add to that, it could be part of the council motion and would be considered as part of their application.
Is there time to have that application, to have the detailed proposal come back to the next council meeting? So rather than us go through, we don't meet for another 2 months, and it would, that would be two council cycles away. Is it possible for us to get the details?
Normally, once we have council approval, we just work directly with the applicant. We don't come back afterwards. In order to, if we had to come back to Aboriginal Affairs Committee, I'm not sure when your next meeting is.
What about if it was directly with council?
It would be, if the next council meeting would be, I guess, the May or July, we could try to expedite that. It'd be nice. Yeah, that's sort of the question. If they don't have the confirmed funding in time to actually make the arrangements for the wall, that's what, that'd be the main concern there.
I just wanted to say that the information I've been providing is just to help people make come to decisions if they can. Anything that I've been providing so far isn't a position that TASC is taking. I just want to make that clear that I had concerns. That was my own concerns coming out of the meeting and not TASC's position. And the second thing is just, again, providing more information, just something to consider. There's also, it just happened to coincide with Water Walkers holding their walk. And they, what came out of the March 9th meeting was that they are partnering with Walk for Reconciliation, and it would be a considerable hardship for them if Walk for Reconciliation didn't continue, because I think, I don't know how funding works between the two, but there was some sort of partnership going on. So they were anxious to see Walk for Reconciliation happen. Just to add further
David?
I think the Water Walkers had already sort of associated themselves with that Ecolog group, though, who had funding from Ontario. And they were a standalone event before Reconciliation Canada ever came along. So I think their project would sort of go ahead no matter what. I don't think its success is tied to Reconciliation Canada.
That was what was explained to me, that it would still go ahead, but it's certainly, this would bolster it.
Bolster, and they probably receive bolstering from the local organization.
That's true. I just wanted to put that out there that there's complexities there. Yeah.
But I think Toronto Council Fire has clearly stated that it's not for the event. So I don't know how productive it is still sort of discussing how this agreement can sort of be redefined or negotiations defined with the group, whether or not we should still be talking about that.
Well, for those that aren't in the room, they gave me pretty clear direction over that they didn't want to stand in the way of us hosting a walk for reconciliation this year. And instead, we're trying to figure out how could we address some of the concerns that I think everyone has expressed very well, and that the lack of local involvement in it. My worry is that given the timeline, if there is room for all that, we certainly won't be able to make everyone around this table happy. And I don't know where we stand at
that special
point. It would be the Aboriginal Affairs Committee saying, we don't believe that this particular organization or the grant.
Would that special event funding be redirected to the water walk?
There would have to be a lot. That's the process.
Okay, well, if that exhausts our speakers list, then I'll probably have to make calls to many of you over the next week before council to see if we can't resolve, resolve this before we give our advice. Larry?
Yeah, sending out a conclusion for myself, and I totally agree with what you're saying. It just, it may not work because of the transparency and involvement with the indigenous community here in Toronto. Because I know the indigenous community, if you don't involve them in these things. But I'm always being positive, I like to see this work for, because there are indigenous people that do it for our people. So I like to see it work, so if, I wish they were here at the table today, that we could discuss this somehow, by how can we come together now that things have happened here? How can we collaborate with the partners, we know that. Because I just don't want to see us in here in Toronto, City County, Toronto, City Hall, ourselves as widely being painted with a negative brush by the work out. And it didn't work out because of the issues I discussed today. But the public won't be aware of that, or indigenous people. So I'd like to just, you guys share with us about your perspective on the feelings about that, because it's the way to organize this community. It's not the way to go. So I want to include that. Myself personally, I believe I want things to work. We're all indigenous people, and things do happen, mistakes do happen, let's get back on a positive note.
And with a working group, perhaps, I hope so.
But that's, I'll ask this.
And you will be the last word as well, Larry. You could give us some words of wisdom as we leave this space.